In this video, I bring to you the book review of a highly anticipated book, Amish Tripathi's latest release, The Legend of Sohail Dev, The King Who Saved India. Now, I will tell you whether you should pick this book up or not. Give it a go or just let it go. I'm Sankalpita and you're watching Book Geeks India, which is a channel where I make book related videos. In this video, like I told you, I bring to you the book review of this book, Amish Tripathi's latest release, The Legend of Sohail Dev, The King Who Saved India. So to buy or to not buy? Now before I delve into the review, I would like to state a few information. Now if you have been following Amish for some time, you know that he has been having this trend of changing the book names. First it was Ravan, whose name changed from The Orphan of Aryavart to The Enemy of Aryavart. Now this book also had its name changed. It was earlier called Sohail Dev and the Battle of Bahraic, but now it is called The Legend of Sohail Dev, The King Who Saved India. And if you have noticed, the cover also has changed. It was something else before. Now it is this cover, which is just fantastic because, yeah, it looks good. Now, this book was supposed to be released in 2018, but somehow that did not happen. Basically, Amish was actually sued by a couple of people, some organizations. So history is a little unsure about Sohail Dev's caste, which should not be such a big matter. But unfortunately, it became, and people sued Amish Tripathi because he had mentioned Sohail Dev's caste as something. But they did not agree. They believed that Sohail Dev belonged to their caste and so. And that is the reason the release date had to be postponed. All the caste-related references which were there in the book had to be taken out. Now, one interesting thing about this book is that this book is not written only by Amish. It says an immortal writer's center book. So this phenomenon of writing Amish has explained in his own words, and let me tell you what he writes. I work with a team of writers to whom I relate the complete story and the research material to be read. They then write the first draft, which I then work upon. So the genesis of the story and the final writing is done by me, while a team drives the first draft. Now we have tried our best to ensure that the books from the writer's center read like any other book of mine, but we wanted to honestly state upfront that these books are a result of a team effort and not just my sole work. Expect a book which is a historical fiction. Expect a book which is neither too lengthy nor too short. It's somewhere in between. It is all of 325 pages. Expect a book which has a lot of action, a little bit of drama, a lot of war and battle scenes, and descriptive action. Like you can imagine the action happening in front of your eyes. Expect a book that takes you to the 11th century AD and the India of that era and tells you a lot about what were the people like, what kind of historical things were happening, who were the kings that ruled, and what were the people suffering from, what were their issues, social, cultural, political issues. Expect a book for beginners. It is not a book that I think will be enjoyed by voracious readers. The book is written in a language that is very simple, and that makes it easy for any beginner level reader to like it. So the story is of a forgotten Indian hero, a ferocious battle that happened in the 11th century AD of India, and it talks to us about a battle that probably changed the entire Indian history. So it is the year 1025 AD, and there have been repeated attacks from the Turkish barbarians who come in from the north, from the Central Asia, and wreak havoc on the cities and the temples of India. They invade, they raid, they loot, they kill, they murder, and they are just too barbaric to be described. Now, there are many old kingdoms that still exist, but somehow these kingdoms have started fighting between themselves. There is a lot of infighting that is happening. They have divided themselves on the basis of small principalities, on the basis of their castes, which is not a good thing. There are still some kingdoms who are willing to fight, but they adhere to this strict code of dharma, this strict code of war that they have to follow diligently. But the Turkish barbarians do not do that. They do not follow any rules, they do not follow any principles, and they constantly devise evil strategies, cunning strategies, which go against the rule of laws, against the established code of conduct, and that is how they keep winning again and again. The most unfortunate incident that happens this time is the destruction, the looting, and the pillaging of one of the holiest temples of ancient India, the Lord Shiva temple at Somnathji. So it is in such desperate times that there arises a king who will change the course of destiny, who will put an end to this pillaging and looting and raiding and invading by Turkish barbarians. And this king is none other than Sohail Dev, the king of Shravasti. there are many characters in the story, but somehow that does not bring a lot of confusion, a lot of complication to the plot. All these characters are required in the plot and they are well maintained also. Now, I would not deny that the characters do not have charisma. They do. But somehow all of them seem so cliche in their respective personalities. Now, if you talk about the physical attributes, the characters are good looking. All of them are good looking, but in a very conventional sort of way. There's nothing different about these characters when it comes to describing their looks. Be it Toshani, the female lead, be it Soheilde, who has this Greek god kind of physique and he has strong muscular arms. All these are established cliches when it comes to describing their physical beauty. Another thing that I want to talk about the characters is that there are certain character transformations, particularly that of Soheilde. So this happens in the beginning, right at the beginning. I'm not going to tell you anything further, but I just want to tell you that the character transformation is so sudden that it is unbelievable. So he's one thing today and the next day, you know, he changes completely. He transforms himself, and that also is not the result of something very tragic, but it just happens and it kind of seems unbelievable. Now, like I told you, there are a lot of characters in the book, but many places the backstories of these characters are missing, and wherever they are, so there is a certain disconnect that happens between the backstories and the present time of these characters, and which kind of seemed forced, kind of seemed unbelievable, kind of seemed unreal. The last thing that I want to point about the character is the female lead. So we have this fiercely loyal and warrior woman called Toshani. Now Toshani is brave, Toshani is independent, and she is fiercely loyal to Soheilde. So we do have an extraordinary woman. But what I did not like here is that she has to be stereotyped as Soheilde's love interest. I mean, why? Do you really have to have a love angle? Why can't a female character be just that, a female character? Does she have to be validated with a romance angle to justify her presence? Coming to the writing style of the book, let us talk about what did I like. Number one, I love the fact that the book talks about this much forgotten hero of our Indian history, somebody who defeated a ruthless killer like Salar Maqsood, and that is something that we really need to appreciate, because Amish is trying to bring back forgotten heroes of our history and bring them into the current consciousness. So it is a really good effort, because not many people know about it, not many people are willing to bring it into the public consciousness. So here I will definitely appreciate this effort by Amish and his team. I also like that there is a lot of action in the book, so it kind of keeps things interesting. It is not that the pace is really fast, it's not. It's a kind of mediocre paced book, but even then there is enough action to keep you hooked throughout the book. Next thing that I like about this book is that the book reflects on wisdom. It has a lot of philosophical things, a lot of musings. It has wisdom that tells you a lot about how India was, how India weakened itself, how India was so divided that outsiders used to take advantage of it. And this is very relevant in current times also, because as a nation, we are still divided. We are divided on caste lines, which is such a problematic thing even now. He also talks about social inclusion. He also talks about the importance of plural narratives, which is again something that Indians need to understand today. We also get to know about so many forgotten kings like Mahipal Tomar of Delhi, like Mihir Bhoj, and so many other great kings who are now a thing of the past, and it's really unfortunate that people don't remember them anymore. Now, there is also a lot of philosophy in the book. So the book is written in such a way that they will kind of fill in the gaps between your understanding of Dharma, and that to a naive person like me is a wonderful thing. Finally, towards the end, the book leaves this tiniest hint towards what the next book can be about, and that was a very, very cleverly put out thing, which I absolutely loved. Now, here are four things that I think could have been better in the book. So number one is elements of surprises and plot twists. Now, these were there in very, very limited doses, and all the surprises that were worked into the story were not very believable. They were very superficial and they somehow lacked something. I also believe that the story could have been so much better, like there was so much scope in terms of character backstories, and some characters did not have stories. Like, I would have loved to know about the childhood of Toshani and Soheilde. That would have made me connect to the characters in a very different manner, but that did not happen. That association, that feel, that empathy towards the character was missing, because there was something missing in the characters themselves. Number three, the climax was a bit lousy. Now, there were certain things that were good about the climax, but somehow it just did not do justice to the whole book. Number four is that certain stories of certain characters were left open-ended, so we don't know about what happened to a certain character, and I found myself asking a lot of questions which were not answered eventually. coming to the things that I did not like, number one was the forced romance. So like I told you, there was a female character and she could have been just a female character, but no, she had to be a love interest only to justify, only to validate her existence. And even then, the romance that she has, the romantic connection that they have together is just not there. It seems so unrealistic, there is no chemistry at all. Number two is the writing. The writing is very amateurish. Now, Amish has written a lot of books before and his readers have a certain level of expectations from him. Now, when he does not do that, we feel disappointed. So that is what happened to me in this book. To sum it up, the writing is not engaging and that magic of Amish Tripathi is missing in this book. Another thing that I found glaringly missing was the historical references. Like, obviously this book talks about history, but I would have loved it if at the back of the book, maybe in the form of a bibliography or suggested reads, Amish had given historical references, historical texts that he had consulted to write this book. The climax seems okayish. There are certain things which are definitely not up to the mark in the climax also, and I can't tell you anything more than this. I don't think the book lacks entertainment. There are certain elements in place which make sure that the reader keeps turning pages after pages after pages. And even though the book is like not a slim read, it's 325 pages, even then I was able to finish it in 1.5 days because there were certain things which kept me going. There were certain things that I was looking forward to. Finally guys, I would have rated this book 4.5 stars, but I do not. I deduct 0.5 because of the forced romance, the sheer absurdity of putting the romance in there, and another 0.5 I deduct for amateurish writing, for not giving me the historical information that I was so seeking, the historical references that I really was expecting from this book. So my final rating for this book is 3.5 out of 5 stars. Now guys, I know this review has been very, very critical. I have actually criticized the book more than I have appreciated it, but that's only because I expect a lot from Amish's writing, and this was such a beautiful subject. It could have been done so well, but sadly it was not. So yes, I've pointed out a lot of mistakes, but that does not mean the book is really trashy. It's not. It's a decent read for a beginner level reader. Like I told you, do not go for it if you are a voracious reader, but even then I think it's a decent effort because it talks about a forgotten hero of India's past, and we need to read stories of such people. So this is my humble request to you, Amish. I am expecting to read more such books, but with a slightly better writing. This time the reader in me was a little disappointed. And that's it from me in this video, guys. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you enjoyed it, don't forget to hit that like. Also subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And until the next video, which will be pretty soon. Bye.